Good afternoon. My name is Jessica Tillotman, and I am the Assistant Dean for Government Procurement Law Studies at GW Law School in Washington, D.C. We are delighted to welcome you to today's program, GW Law Perspectives on the Inflation Reduction Act. The Inflation Reduction Act, or IRA, of 2022 was signed into law by President Joe Biden on August 16th, 2022, and has been called the single largest investment in climate and energy in American history, enabling America to tackle the climate crisis, advancing environmental justice, securing America's position as a world leader in domestic clean energy manufacturing, among other things. The law also aims to reduce the deficit, lower prescription drug prices, and includes tax reform provisions, among other things. The focus of today's discussion will be on how the IRA impacts four critical areas of the law: environmental law, energy law, sustainable procurement, and environmental justice. I am delighted to be joined by an esteemed panel of experts who are also my colleagues, who will help provide an introduction to the IRA for those of us who are not yet familiar with the voluminous legislation's provisions. We will also discuss how this law impacts their particular areas of expertise. So without further ado, I will introduce our esteemed panel. First, we have Dean Randall Abate, who is the Assistant Dean for Environmental Law Studies, Dean Donna Atanasio, the Assistant Dean for Energy Law, Professor Robert Glicksman, the J.B. and Maurice C. Shapiro Professor of Environmental Law, and Professor Steve Schooner, the Nash and Sabinick Professor of Government Procurement Law. So, a few logistics before we get started. At any point during today's 75-minute discussion, please feel free to put your questions in either the chat function or the Q&A function of Zoom. We'll be happy to answer them. Some of them we'll answer in real time, and some of them we will answer live at the end when we get to the question and answer portion. So please, again, we love your questions. Do not, do not hesitate to ask your questions throughout. So we're going to go ahead and set the table with today's discussion. We're going to start with Professor Glicksman. Rob, just for those of us that are less familiar with this area of the law, can you provide a short history of the federal regulation of greenhouse gas emissions under the Clean Air Act and what impact, if any, the IRA has on these efforts?
Yes, I can. Thanks, Jessica. So Congress began getting into the business of environmental regulation early in the 1970s, and it quickly passed a statute that was designed to protect air quality, the Clean Air Act, passed the Clean Water Act, it passed a statute that was designed to regulate management of hazardous waste, it passed a statute to protect endangered species, but it didn't protect a Climate Change Act. In fact, it's never adopted a statute until the IRA that was directed significantly at climate change activities. And so when environmental groups and environmental advocates began hunting around for a way to force the government to address greenhouse gases that contribute to climate change, it focused on the Clean Air Act as the most logical starting point. And an NGO located in DC, represented in fact by a GW law grad, filed a petition with EPA asking EPA to regulate greenhouse gas emissions from motor vehicles, cars, trucks, and buses. Under a provision of the statute that authorizes EPA to regulate newly manufactured motor vehicles whose emissions can reasonably be anticipated to endanger public health or welfare. The petition argued that, well, greenhouse gases do exactly that. They endanger public health and welfare, and therefore EPA, you have a duty to regulate them. EPA, under the George W. Bush administration, let the petition lie around for quite a while until finally it denied the petition on two grounds. Number one, that greenhouse gases don't qualify as air pollutants and therefore aren't covered by the Clean Air Act. Number two, even if they are, that regulating greenhouse gas emissions from motor vehicles at that time would have been a bad idea. Only if, for example, because it would have dissuaded other countries from joining us in the effort if we went in on our own without putting pressure on other countries to do so. That denial was challenged, and the case went all the way up to the US Supreme Court. which issued a decision in a case called Massachusetts versus EPA in 2007. And in that case, the court rejected both of EPA's grounds for denying the petition. It said, first of all, the definition of air pollutants is very broad and clearly covers greenhouse gases. And number two, all the policy reasons EPA advanced for denying the petition had nothing to do with the scope of its authority under the statute. And so the court remanded the case back to EPA to rethink the question of whether or not it would be willing to regulate greenhouse gases from motor vehicles. The Trump administration ran out. When the Obama administration took office, it issued what's called an endangerment finding, which basically concluded that yes, the petitioners were right. Greenhouse gases from motor vehicles do adversely affect public health and welfare. And ultimately, the Obama administration issued regulations that restricted greenhouse gases from newly manufactured vehicles. That regulation triggered, under the arcane provisions of the Clean Air Act, EPA's authority to regulate so-called stationary sources as well, that is, factories that emit greenhouse gases. And the Obama administration tried to do that by issuing what it's called its Clean Power Plan, which is designed to regulate greenhouse gas emissions from existing electric power plants, which are the largest industrial source of greenhouse gas emissions in the country. The Supreme Court basically blocked implementation of that plan. The Trump administration, when it came into office, repealed the plan and issued a weaker version, which the Biden administration basically blocked with the intent of replacing it with its own version. That version hasn't yet been adopted. So we have increasingly stringent regulation of motor vehicle emissions, but not much in the way of regulation of stationary source emissions yet, although I have no doubt that the Biden administration has that teed up for ultimate regulation as well. So what does the Inflation Reduction Act do to all this? Let me hold my fire here and let the others get us started, and I'll answer that question later on.
Sounds good. Thank you, Rob. All right, Dean Attanasio. Donna, the IRA includes tax credits, government loans, and other incentives for clean energy to help accelerate decarbonization of the energy sector. Past incentive programs similar to these have helped fuel a very fast-growing renewable sector, but overall renewable energy still only meets a small part of the U.S. demand for energy. Is there anything new about the IRA approach that is going to change this trajectory?
Yes. The short answer is yes. There's a lot in this bill. I would start by going back to the points about the fact that there are some similarities. If we look at the growth of renewable energy in this country so far, there have really been probably three major drivers. One is, at least in the electric sector, the state setting criteria, what are called renewable portfolio standards, for how much electricity had to come from renewable resources. Then you had tax provisions. We have a very long history of burying our energy policy in the tax code, which is a challenge for people like me who are not tax lawyers. But I've gotten to know a few sections. And so we were giving production tax credits and investment tax credits, PTC and ITC. PTC is based on how much is produced, and ITC is based on the amount of the investment. And those have been very successful in helping us build out the wind and solar sectors in particular, although they did apply to some other sectors as well. And then the third factor was, once you had those in place, prices started dropping. And so we saw in the electric sector in particular a large growth in the amount of renewables, to the point where now, back in the electric sector, about 20% of our electricity is coming from renewable energy. But that means 60% of it is still coming from fossil fuels, with about 20% coming, a little bit less actually now, from the nuclear sector. Looking at the economy overall, as Rob was referencing, you know, we have made progress in other areas as well, but still, when we look at renewables, about 12% of the energy we are consuming in the U.S. is coming from renewables. So that's a pretty low percentage still. So what's different about this bill? And why do I think it's going to be more successful? Well, first of all, we are building on that success. We are continuing to build out our tax code with more energy policy. So all the tax lawyers out there, just as my former tax partners used to say, don't talk about energy without having me in the room. So there's a lot here for no lawyer to be left behind. I think the timing is important. More and more, we're seeing the public being aware of climate change and being interested in climate change. If we go back to 2020, Pew did a survey and they found, I think it was 65, just let me check my note here, 65%, 63% of Americans believe climate change was having at least some effect on their community, and 65% thought the federal government was doing too little about it. So we have that. Now, I know that this bill was pretty much, you know, a Republican-Democratic split. But the other thing that's really exciting about this bill is the breadth of it. We are going after sectors that have been hard to decarbonize, like the industrial sector. We are putting incentives in there to bring, to incentivize the use of, or to incentivize prevailing wages and apprenticeship programs and Made in America. We're going down the supply chains. I'm sure that Steve will talk more about this, but we're really trying to reach out across the economy and bring in more people. There are provisions in this bill to make sure that it's reaching the middle class and lower income people as well. And being able to change hearts and minds really matters in this. Certainly every time there's a change of administration, people are like, oh, you know, we don't want to do what that other, those other folks did. But when people are getting the incentives, it's much harder to change, just as we saw with the Affordable Care Act. People that had insurance want to keep that insurance. Here, again, if people are getting jobs in the clean energy economy, if they're seeing a difference in their communities, they're going to want to keep it. So I think those are some of the really important parts about this bill that will make it different.
Thanks, Donna. Steve, what is sustainable procurement? And also, what does the IRA say, if anything, about it?
Well, so much to say, but with apologies, I'm going to go in the reverse order. For anybody who is here primarily for the procurement angle, it's relatively obvious that the IRA was not a conventional government contracts or public procurement legislative vehicle. It is far more broad, as Donna already alluded to. It touches many, many different sectors of the community. So in many ways, it's more disaggregated. But having said that, to me, the single biggest win from a procurement angle on this, particularly in the context of climate change, is it has us talking about it. We've got the topic on the table. For those of you who are familiar with Catherine Hayhoe's book, Saving Us, she reminds us that one of the most important things we can do to address climate change and change behavior is to talk about it. So we're talking about it, and that's great. In any event, to the question, though, in terms of sustainable procurement, when we say sustainable procurement, we're talking about how governments can use their purchasing power, and in many countries, their significant purchasing power, to help governments adapt to climate change and also attempt to mitigate climate change. For those who don't follow procurement, the scale of potential money available is enormous. In the US federal marketplace, the federal government spends $500, sometimes $600 billion a year buying goods, services, infrastructure, construction. But that's dwarfed by the spending of the 50 states and unlimited municipalities and regional instrumentalities. Just think about how large the New York Port Authority is, or WMATA, or the DC Airports Authority. And then, of course, there's all of the international and comparative, because governments around the world are significantly ahead of the United States in focusing on deploying this money to address these critical issues. But to make it more complex, and I'll come back to this a little bit later, when we talk about sustainable procurement, it's a wildly diverse range of issues. On the one hand, the government buys lots and lots of conventional commercial goods, just like consumers. And there is, for example, on the GSA federal supply schedule, there's an environmental aisle. You can buy goods that already have an eco label on them or have been approved. In the construction industry, the coin of the realm these days is the LEED standard, L-E-E-D. And I think GSA, our primary construction purchaser, is far ahead of the curve in deploying and awarding and applauding LEED endeavors. But the much bigger one for many is the supply chain. And maybe later we'll talk about EPA's rubric for self-assessment by the private sector of scope one, scope two, and scope three GHG emissions. And I think it's really significant as to how we assess not only our direct impact, but our indirect effects and our supply chain. But the most interesting aspect, or the biggest challenge, or one of the biggest challenges in public procurement, is for so long, culturally, intellectually, emotionally, we have thought of low prices as the coin of the realm. So if we really want to make the kind of investments in what are often referred to as green procurement, or sustainable procurement, or environmentally preferable procurement, we need to overcome the tyranny of low prices. We need to rethink the value proposition. If you pay a really low price for something and it doesn't work, it wasn't a bargain. That's a false economy. But if we want to internalize the externalities associated with climate change, and that's everything from floods and fires and storms to water shortages and food shortages and migration and regional instability, we have to internalize that through life cycle cost analysis. Let me say one last thing on this. The biggest thing that we often don't think about when we talk about sustainable procurement is what we in the profession refer to as requirements generation. And frankly, one of the biggest challenges for many government officials is understanding that they don't need to do the same thing they've done before, and there are alternative ways of doing things that will fundamentally have a less harmful footprint in terms of climate change. But we'll come back to all those issues. And again, that's enough to get started for now.
Thanks, Steve. Randy, what is environmental justice, and what are some examples of how environmental justice considerations are being integrated into federal government initiatives, and more specifically, the IRA?
Thank you, Jessica. It's great to be here on this terrific panel, really enjoying the opportunity to have this conversation. As Jessica mentioned, the IRA is an overwhelming document that it takes a village to get through it. So I'm glad we're having this discussion. So my role is the environmental justice dimensions of the IRA. And so to begin that discussion, I want to make sure we're all on the same page about what environmental justice refers to. So this is a term that grew out of the late 1980s in the US, in that it recognizes that certain communities are disproportionately burdened by environmental problems. And so this phenomenon was first identified in the Southeast US in the late 1980s, and many studies were conducted there that were revealing that the siting of hazardous and medical waste facilities, landfills, and heavy industry were occurring almost exclusively in Black communities. And the awareness of this burdening of marginalized communities spread beyond the Black population to reveal this pattern nationwide of burdening of other minority and low-income communities, including Indigenous communities, that were similarly disproportionately burdened by environmental problems, and another dimension, that they similarly lacked access to environmental benefits like clean drinking water and parks. And so certainly the Flint, Michigan crisis drew attention to that access to drinking water reality of environmental justice within the past decade. And so more recently, and much closer to home for today's discussion, the environmental justice movement has gone through stages, and really the latest stage of it is how it has evolved to embrace climate justice as another version of how environmental justice issues manifest themselves. So much like the siting of environmentally undesirable facilities in frontline communities, EJ communities also often bear a disproportionate burden from climate change impacts. Those communities are more directly in harm's way when we talk about climate impacts, and they're least equipped to adapt to those impacts. So some of many examples would include the victims of Hurricane Katrina in New Orleans' Ninth Ward, and Indigenous communities in the Arctic facing displacement from melting ice. So environmental justice protections from a legal perspective typically involve procedural mechanisms, such as a right to participate or to be consulted in processes, and also funding measures, some of which I'll discuss today in connection with the IRA. It's important to know that efforts to establish substantive legal protections have encountered many political and legal barriers in the environmental justice field. And that's a discussion for another day, but I wanted to make you aware of that. So turning to the second part of the question regarding examples, it's very encouraging that there are many, many examples in the Biden-Harris administration of environmental justice considerations being integrated into the federal government's initiatives. And the IRA is the latest example, not directly attributable to the administration. This is a congressional enactment, but nonetheless, a federal government engagement on these issues. So I'll just give a few examples. So all but one of these really within the past year. In May of this year, the White House Council on Environmental Quality released a report to Congress describing the administration's efforts to implement the recommendations from what's known as the White House Environmental Justice Advisory Council. WEJAC is the acronym. And the administration established WEJAC to tackle these longstanding environmental injustices that were occurring to the marginalized, underserved, and overburdened communities, and to have a greater so that they could have greater input on federal policies and decision-making. And so the WEJAC recommendations encouraged federal agencies to initiate changes to protect these communities. And relevant to today's discussion, some of those recommendations include implementing clean energy in low-income communities and creating community-based transportation and investing in disaster recovery. Another example is the October 21 report on the impact of climate change on migration. This was a long anticipated report, and in some ways there was a fair amount of criticism of it, that much of what was in the report was merely restating the problem of how climate change is such a threat multiplier for displacement. Ultimately there were not many recommendations for how to proceed from the report. Just identifying it as an important issue is nonetheless an important first step. And very recently in August of this year, NOAA Fisheries, another federal agency, released an equity and environmental justice strategy for how it conducts its management of what's within its jurisdiction, and included there was providing equitable delivery of NOAA Fisheries services and prioritizing environmental justice considerations in their mandate and their mission work. And lastly, and interestingly, this came out first from the Biden administration, is the Justice 40 initiative. And so this was merely days after taking office, President Biden signed an executive order that requires federal agencies to direct 40%, hence the Justice 40 name, 40% of federal benefits from various climate-related programs to disadvantaged communities that are marginalized and overburdened by pollution. So here's all I'll say for now about the IRA's relationship to all of that context, and we'll explore it in more depth in the follow-up round of questions. So we've got all that great news, which is really exciting, especially comparing to where we were in the past 30 years on environmental justice initiatives from the federal government. But the IRA is poised to be the crown jewel of all these efforts to promote environmental justice. And I'll describe some of the impressive funding provisions and the breadth of scope of what the IRA does in this regard, and how it's positioned to do much more than the executive orders and initiatives that preceded it, because it is in fact legislation, and that gives it some very important bite to it. And I'll stop there.
Steve?
So I have to say, it's so important and so significant to hear Randy talk about these things. But let me start with a slightly more negative spin, and that is one of the most interesting things as you read more about climate change is it's jarring how poorly the media has drawn the correlations that demand that we think more about environmental justice. The bottom line is we just don't think about it enough. And to take a slightly different angle to get to the same point that Randy was at, one thing that's really interesting, and I know we have an international audience today, is what we've learned is that the countries that have most contributed to climate change are the ones that currently have the best resources to adapt to it. And the countries and the regions that have contributed the least to climate change are the ones who are least able to adapt to it and are the ones who are going to suffer the most, particularly if you think about food and water shortages, which of course leads to migration, which Randy already talked about, and the burgeoning refugee populations that will lead to regional instability, which is one of the greatest pending fears that our Department of Defense thinks about all the time. So again, the environmental justice issue is that those of us who have lived the life we lived and enjoyed it for now for generations are the ones best able to build higher seawalls and to move further north and to install more air conditioning and pay more for our water. But those who didn't contribute to it ultimately are having their lives and their homes upended. But now let me put this in the context of the IRA. And to me, it's one of the most significant disappointments. And it's a good news story, but it also shows the pathologies. For example, there is a tremendous amount of investment in the kind of infrastructure that will make it easier to own, drive, and operate electric vehicles in the United States. But as many of you may know, the average EV that was purchased in this country last year, and I bought one, actually I'm leasing it, but I have one, the average price was over $50,000. In other words, the people who are driving EVs really didn't need the tax incentive, but gee, it's really nice, okay? Conversely, if that money had instead gone to electric bicycles or electric cargo bikes, then the people whose lives would be changed by that subsidy would have been far, far greater. The kind of subsidy that it takes to get one electric vehicle on the road could have led to dozens of people riding electric bikes or electric cargo bikes and fundamentally enhancing the quality of their lives. But again, the tax credit's going to go to people who really didn't need it, but maybe it'll spur the market a little bit. The other thing to think about is what we aren't seeing enough of, and frankly, this is federal legislation, it's a little bit harder, but the classic solutions that we really need to be thinking about with climate change to get people off the road in a fair way is, for example, what they did in Spain recently. They made the trains free. Geneva has experimented with making public transportation free in the metro area. As many of you know, DC is now subsidizing metro rail passes. But that's the way you get cars off the road and you actually create opportunities for people who directly benefit from it. For those of you who have traveled in rural Africa or Asia, you know that many, many homes for many, many years on their roof have a single solar panel and a water tank. Okay? We can do big infrastructure things, but imagine how significantly this could have helped poorer communities if we were able to give them simple devices or install them for free. Again, that could be life changers. But again, I think the big point that I want to make here is I can't tell you what a pleasure it is at GW Law to now have somebody like Randy on the team who's going to help our students and our community focus on the environmental justice aspects as we talk about the larger issues on climate change. Thanks.
Rob?
Yeah, I have a couple of points I'd like to follow up on what Randy and Steve have been talking about. So the international community has recognized the unfairness of the developed countries like the US and the EU having generated most of the greenhouse gases. They're now disproportionately adversely affecting third world countries. And the international treaties that have been created to deal with climate change, including the Paris Agreement, have sought to address that by creating funds into which developed countries will contribute, then be accessible by countries, let's say in Africa or South America or Asia, to draw on to help them adjust to the adverse consequences and mitigate the adverse consequences of climate change. Now, the countries who made those commitments haven't been terribly good about abiding by them. I don't think that the contributions have flowed in to the extent that they should have if the commitments had been abided by. And hopefully that will change. But and the Inflation Reduction Act, as far as I know, doesn't make any direct contributions to international funds of that sort. But it may be that the world will take note of what the U.S. Congress has done in the Inflation Reduction Act and said, okay, well, the U.S. is finally getting serious about doing something to deal with climate change. And now it's our turn to contribute as well. And so hopefully the Inflation Reduction Act sets a precedent that restores the U.S. as sort of a leader in the fight against climate change and its inequities. The other point I would make to follow up on Steve's discussion is the importance of getting cars off the road. So auto emissions have been a significant problem. I think they're the largest single source of greenhouse gas emissions in the country, even greater than emissions from electric utilities. And generally, more cars are on the road all the time, traveling more miles. We actually did see a dip in greenhouse gas emissions from the auto sector during COVID. And that's because people weren't on the road. They weren't driving to work. They were staying home. So that's sort of a case study that shows us that, yes, we can make a difference if we somehow reduce the amount of auto congestion on the roads and hopefully funnel people into either teleworking part of the time or using public transportation to get to work so they don't have to use their cars.
I'm actually, just as a quick question, as out of curiosity, as the person with the least experience in this area, you said that greenhouse gas emissions dropped, and we noticed that has not necessarily sustained at shutdown levels, but because so many more people are teleworking, has it not gone back up to what it was pre-pandemic? Does anybody know? Or did I just throw?
I think it's increasing again, but I don't know that it's completely reach pre-pandemic levels. I mean, you've got greater industrial activity now than you did in 2020, for example, as well. And so things are moving in the wrong direction. Hopefully the IRA will put a halt to that and the IRS as it implements the Inflation Reduction Act's tax provisions.
Got it.
Donna. One thing that I heard about post-pandemic realities is that there's a phenomenon known as like revenge travel going on now that things are somewhat back to normal. So there was a bit of a higher spike than there should have been from those years of squirreling away, which were excellent for the environment in many ways. There were all kinds of studies that species were returning to habitats where they hadn't been found recently, and the levels dropped to a point that was close to post-World War II. And that changed very quickly as soon as folks were able to get back to their old habits. They did it with a vengeance, and so we're pretty much back to square one.
Yay. Okay, Donna.
I just want to follow up on a couple of those points. I mean, Rob is right. It used to be the electric sector was the biggest emitter of greenhouse gases, and that did drop as the electric industry became a little bit cleaner. Basically, transportation became the number one. And that's been what's been driving a lot of this move towards electric vehicles. There's been a big push to say, oh, we can clean up the electric sector, and so therefore we can clean up the transportation sector by electrifying it. But as I pointed out, we haven't cleaned up the electric sector yet. It is still 60% renewable fuels. 60% fossil fuels. And so, you know, we're kind of in this area where we're kind of thinking, oh, if we electrify everything, that will be wonderful. But that really isn't entirely true unless we're also cleaning up that sector too. I also just wanted to pick up on Steve's point about the electric vehicles. And by the way, I second everything you're saying about we need to be doing more about, you know, the bikes and walking and other ways to get ourselves out of cars. And I'm certainly among the offenders. But one of the things I did like about this bill is that the credits for electric vehicles are in the secondary market now. You can get $4,000 or 30% of the vehicle price as your rebate, as opposed to the $7,500 that we were doing before. And furthermore, it doesn't apply to a vehicle that costs in excess of $55,000 for a passenger vehicle, or $80,000 for like a van, SUV, truck. So there's an effort to sort of say, okay, let's stop just subsidizing the rich folks, and let's try to make sure that this is more accessible. It's not gonna make everybody be able to afford an EV, but it's certainly moving in the right direction. And then together with that, there's also money in there for charging stations. It will go through 2032, and it's for charging stations that are gonna be in either low income or rural areas. And the rural areas in particular are very difficult to otherwise decarbonize, because, you know, we still have a range issue with batteries, and we're still working on that too. There's money in there for batteries. But those range issues do inhibit our use of electric vehicles as well. And this bill is trying to address those problems.
Donna, I want to stick with you for a second. Can you talk a little bit more? I mean, you just touched on it briefly about some of the technologies. Is there additional technologies that we should be aware of that the IRA touches on?
Yeah, absolutely. So this bill is very broad-based. Now, one thing I have to say I really do like about it, and this actually is sort of the antithesis of that question, but right now we have this production tax credit and investment tax credit, and those have largely gone to push the solar and wind industry, although there are other technologies that are eligible for them. That's primarily where those have gone. But those are going to be phasing out, and in their place, we're going to get a 10-year credit that is technology neutral. So production tax credit or investment tax credit, you pick one or the other, but it doesn't really matter what the technology is. The point is they've got to be clean technology. So we're opening up the door to more innovation and more opportunity. Some of the particular provisions that I am excited about are hydrogen. Again, in the same vein, I'm still in the tax code here, which I probably should, you know, be sued for malpractice or something for practicing tax law. But the provisions for the hydrogen, again, we have a production tax credit and investment tax credit. But this is, first of all, building on what was in the bipartisan infrastructure bill that provided for these hydrogen hubs, this idea that we were going to create areas in which we would concentrate production and use of hydrogen. And the reason why that's important is, first of all, there's a number of sectors that need very high density sources of energy, steel, for example. And hydrogen can provide that, advanced nuclear can provide that, electricity can't. So if we're talking about decarbonizing, we've got to figure out something besides electricity to work for these. So I'm very excited that we are including hydrogen, we're including advanced nuclear. On the hydrogen, we're building on what's already in the bipartisan infrastructure bill, and then coming in with these additional credits actually producing or to build the facilities that can do them. Again, on the nuclear, we now have a credit for nuclear, which we didn't have before. So there's a lot of pieces in here that are pushing the technologies that we need to be able to cover that bridge of what electricity is not going to do for us, what renewables per se are not going to do for us. And we're trying to make them more technology and fuel neutral. So again, going back to the hydrogen, the point is not how you produce the hydrogen, not whether it's blue hydrogen or green hydrogen. It's how much is the life cycle greenhouse gas emission of the process going to be. And the lower it is, the better it is. If it's over 4 kilograms, then it doesn't qualify for the incentives.
Thanks, Donna. Steve, I'm going to turn back to you. The procurement workforce or acquisition workforce issues is a longstanding and ongoing and growing problem in the United States, just generally. But now we're talking about adding a new layer to everything, a new component and to the procurement process, which can be challenging. Could you talk a little bit about the impact of these efforts on the workforce, and are we ready?
So the short answer to are we ready is no. But let's talk about the procurement workforce as the elephant in the room issue. It is a classic failure of policymakers to assume that you can change behavior by passing laws. Bottom line is the procurement process is regulated by legislation and regulation, but the challenge is implementation, because the process, each individual procurement, each transaction is driven by people, and people are human, and people are risk averse and have numerous other pathologies. But let me just try to distill this massive issue into 4 daunting challenges that our federal procurement workforce faces. And let me say this, the United States has the most well-trained, highly credentialed, and experienced public procurement workforce in the world. And so these challenges are more daunting at the state and the municipal level, and particularly in developing countries as well. But 4 big challenges. The first is the massive learning curve. If we go back to where Rob was talking earlier, I can walk into a room and talk about the EPA's rubric to measure scope 1, 2, and 3 emissions. But But that requires a fair amount of learning to actually understand that and use it to prefer one vendor over another. In addition, depending upon the different things you buy, you may have to learn technologies, you may have to learn new vocabulary. It's just plain hard. And I dropped into the chat a little bit earlier an article that I published last year, and the only goal in that article was to try to give the public procurement community some common vocabulary and nomenclature so we could even start the conversation. Okay, so challenge number one is a learning curve. Challenge number two, and let's just call this the one that's really hard to talk about, and that is the acquisition workforce is busy, they're overworked, and they're pulled in a lot of different directions. And I often use, let me just say that I often use the example of the movie The Incredibles when I talk about this. One of the themes from the original Incredibles movie is that when everybody is special, nobody's special. And if you ask the public procurement community to further multiple social goals in addition to getting low prices and high quality, what you in effect say is nothing is important, just try to do everything, but it doesn't matter. The best example I can give you on this is that in the United States, for public procurement officials, normally the most important thing they have to do is make sure that small businesses get 25% of all the procurement dollars we spend, because that gets measured and it gets reported to Congress, and senior officials get yelled at if the agencies don't do that. Just last week, the Biden administration put out an executive order raising the percentage goal for small disadvantaged businesses. What the acquisition workforce heard is that's important to the administration. And until the administration says sustainable procurement is more important than that, it's not just more important, it's not important at all. And if you ever want to get a real sense of this, just read the acquisition planning provisions in the Federal Acquisition Regulation. And basically it tells you to do 1,000 things and doesn't suggest that any are more important than the others, so they're not. Okay, two more things. For the workforce, there is a longstanding bias in the United States about NIY or not invented here. Well, what's frustrating about that is there are wonderful case studies from around the world and from the state and local governments. And so the rest of the world is actively engaged in a conversation of sharing best practices, lessons learned, case studies and models. And historically, the United States has not wanted to adopt creative things that other governments have done. They want to come up with it themselves. So that's going to be a problem. We don't have time for tens of thousands of public procurement officials to start reinventing the wheel. The last one, and this is the most challenging intellectually, is we need to rethink the value proposition. Again, most good or environmentally preferable purchases often require paying upfront some type of price premium. And what we know is that over time, many of these investments pay for themselves. But the average public procurement official in the United States is assessed on the purchase prices they get and is not well versed in making compelling arguments or doing the analysis that we often think of as life cycle cost analysis. And that's the way that we internalize the externalities or the effects of the things that we buy. In this conversation, everybody who's here today probably understands that if you buy a hybrid automobile and you pay a price premium and you keep it and drive it for a long time, it'll probably be less expensive over the life cycle of your ownership or your total ownership cost than if you bought the fossil fuel vehicle, and it's less harmful to the environment. But for people who are assessed on low purchase prices or haven't been trained to think in the long term or aren't responsible for the ramification of their purchases, this is a fundamental, a paradigm shifting ask to have them think in terms about long-term value rather than low purchase prices. So we have our work cut out for us.
Thanks, Steve. Randy, let's turn back to environmental justice issues. We know that the IRA directs billions towards these efforts, and particularly directing it to communities based on a variety of criteria, including income, energy, burden and demographics. But critics have also argued that these kind of advances are offset or outweighed by other provisions in the act relating to investment in coal, oil and gas, nuclear, hydrogen and biofuels that actually disproportionately impact these particular communities. Is it a net gain? Is there a net gain for these communities or not?
Thank you, Jessica. There, those concerns are certainly well-grounded. There's no question that the IRA is far from perfect as a tool to protect environmental justice communities for the reasons you mentioned and others. But despite those imperfections, the IRA absolutely is a net gain for EJ communities. And I want to just cover a few brief points as to why. The first point is really the most important in that the IRA allocates about $50 billion in direct benefits for communities with EJ concerns. I mean, that number is remarkable. So I'll say it again. The IRA allocates about $50 billion in direct benefits to EJ communities. Now, in putting that into perspective, the climate obligation or debt, if you will, that the U.S. is contributing to on a global scale through this Green Climate Fund, it's supposed to be contributing $10 billion, not $50 billion, $10 billion per year. And the U.S. is balking at that figure as being too high. And yet in this legislation, $50 billion is going to EJ communities. So that's a remarkable investment in a potentially game-changing outcomes for these communities if it's implemented effectively. So that's another perspective on that is that it's nearly twice the amount that the Biden administration allocated under the Justice 40 initiative, which was an executive order and certainly at that time one of the most ambitious efforts to advance EJ in our country's history. And the IRA is doubling that that allocation that we see in the Justice 40 initiative. So another important reality though, is that when we're comparing the impact of an executive order versus legislation of Congress, states and non-federal entities, other non-federal entities beyond states aren't required to comply with Justice 40. That only binds federal agencies. And by contrast, several of the IRA's EJ programs require state and local governments implementing the programs to prioritize disadvantaged communities with EJ concerns. So even though the IRA doesn't include provisions to hold state and local government actors accountable for noncompliance under the IRA, it still shifts the burden onto the funding recipients to justify spending that conflicts with these provisions. So it provides some degree of accountability with that measure in place, even though we don't have a traditional enforcement mechanism to ensure compliance. So overall, it's really a tremendous gain for EJ. And yes, there are plenty of criticisms we could lodge, and I can address a few of those later.
Thanks. Let us turn to Rob now. We set the table with a brief intro into the Clean Air Act. So now let's focus and turn to what impact does the IRA have on the EPA's regulatory authority under the Clean Air Act, if any?
Yes, it does, although not in the ways you might expect. So let me pick up the story that I began earlier. So the Obama administration issued this thing called the Clean Power Plan that was designed to limit greenhouse gas emissions from existing mostly coal-fired, natural gas-fired electric power plants. And the plan essentially delegated broad discretion to the states to figure out how they wanted to regulate their own utilities. But the idea was to push utilities to switch their sources of fuel from fossil fuels to renewable energy. This was called generation shifting. The Trump administration repealed the Clean Power Plan and issued its Affordable Clean Energy Rule in its stead. The Affordable Clean Energy Rule was significantly weaker than the Obama plan, and in fact, claimed that the agency lacked the authority under the Clean Air Act to push for generation shifting. The Trump plan or rule was challenged by environmental groups in blue states in federal court. and the Court of Appeals for the DC Circuit invalidated the Trump rule, arguing that it misinterpreted the statute, and the statute was plenty broad enough to allow EPA to induce states to try and encourage generation shifting by electric utilities. That decision was then appealed to the Supreme Court, which rendered a decision in a case last summer called West Virginia versus EPA. And in that case, the Supreme Court overturned the DC Circuit's decision and said, no, Trump's EPA had it right. The statute provides very limited authority to EPA to regulate emissions from existing power plants. In particular, it doesn't authorize generation shifting. So the court did not reach the conclusion that EPA lacks the authority to regulate greenhouse gas emissions at all under the Clean Air Act. There was some fear that it might do that. It didn't even conclude that it has no authority to regulate greenhouse gas emissions from electric power plants, but it certainly reduced the scope of EPA's discretion in figuring out how to do that. So what impact, if any, does the Inflation Reduction Act have on West Virginia versus EPA and its interpretation of the Clean Air Act? It doesn't overrule West Virginia versus EPA. It doesn't expand EPA's regulatory authority in general or with respect to emissions from electric power plants. In fact, the statute doesn't really have any regulatory provisions at all. What it does do, however, is several things. First, in several provisions of the act, maybe about a dozen, the statute says, we're defining greenhouse gases as air pollutants that have the following effects. To shorten that, greenhouse gases qualify as air pollutants. That's significant because even though the Supreme Court agreed with that in Massachusetts versus EPA back in 2007, there were several dissenting justices who disagreed with that. And there was some concern that the current makeup of the court might go back and overrule Massachusetts versus EPA and conclude that Congress never intended for EPA to be able to regulate greenhouse gases. That's no longer a viable argument. Congress has clearly endorsed the notion that the Clean Air Act is intended to cover greenhouse gas emissions. And so the Inflation Reduction Act doesn't enhance EPA's authority, but it provides kind of a reassurance that the Supreme Court can't totally gut EPA's authority to regulate greenhouse gases. Now, the statute, again, although it's not directly regulatory, does enhance the ability of EPA to use the Clean Air Act to address greenhouse gas emissions in a couple of ways. It provides a whole lot of money to monitor emissions of pollutants by industry, municipalities, utilities, et cetera. Some of this monitoring will go to so-called co-pollutants, that is pollutants that are generated along with carbon dioxide when fossil fuels are used to generate electricity. These are things like particulate matter and sulfur dioxide and precursors of ozone, which are very harmful to public health. So if EPA has enhanced the ability to monitor emissions, it can use these monitoring results to enhance its enforcement authority of existing regulations under the Clean Air Act, both in terms of greenhouse gas emissions and these more conventional co-pollutants. The other thing that the statute does by way of assisting EPA's ability to enforce the Clean Air Act is to provide subsidies to various industries that are regulated under the Clean Air Act to help them do things like develop more energy, environmentally friendly technologies. So some money is funneled into research and development into carbon sequestration as a means of capturing greenhouse gas emissions before they ever get into the air. These subsidies will make it cheaper for industries to take steps to reduce their greenhouse gas emissions, which will in turn mute their arguments, if not entirely negate their arguments, that EPA's asks under existing Clean Air Act regulations are too stringent, are not economically achievable. They're more economically achievable than they were before the statute was enacted, because subsidies are provided to help industries do what EPA is going to be asking them to do. Final thing I'll mention is that most of the Inflation Reduction Act provisions are in the form of positive incentives, carrots rather than sticks. But there's one very important stick in the statute. It's a stick that relates to methane emissions. That's important because methane emissions are about 20 times more potent as a greenhouse gas on a ton-for-ton basis than carbon dioxide. So if we really want to make a significant impact on reducing contributions of greenhouse gases to climate change, you ought to go after methane emissions. The statute imposes fees on industries that generate methane emissions above a certain amount, and the fees will increase over tax years 2024, 25, and 26. So these are strong negative incentives that will induce industries to reduce their methane emissions, for example, by trying to avoid leaks in pipelines that transport natural gas, leaks or venting or flaring of natural gas at natural gas production sites, in order to reduce tax liability. So the money will be shifted from basically regulation to incentives to reduce methane emissions to avoid tax liability. So all those are ways that indirectly the statute will have regulatory impacts, even though it doesn't on its face increase EPA's regulatory authority.
Thanks, Rob. Steve, I know if anybody follows Steve on Twitter or LinkedIn, they know that he is not a huge fan, understatement of the century, of the USPS contract related to the replacement of its fleet. So does the IRA's, do the IRA's provisions actually adequately address your concerns as it relates to this issue?
So the short answer is no, they do not adequately address my concerns, but like so many things, they're better than nothing, and I applaud that. But for anybody who hasn't followed it, the Postal Service Fleet Replacement Contract is a brilliant case study on so many relevant issues that it really merits your attention. So first of all, what many people forget is the original procurement to replace 150,000 old, inefficient, unsafe trucks was a pretty good procurement, and it actually included total cost of ownership or life cycle cost analysis. The problem was the Postal Service then ignored the analysis they were supposed to do and decided to replace the old inefficient trucks with new inefficient, safer, fossil fuel burning trucks. And when I say inefficient, I mean really inefficient. Now, fortunately, there was some excellent pushback by the Environmental Protection Agency, by the public, by Congress, and the Postal Service has backed away a little bit, going to 90%, and now they've moved down in the direction of maybe only 60% being fossil fuel trucks, and maybe that will change over time. But bottom line is, in 2022, there's really no excuse for a customer like the United States government to be buying a massive fleet of fossil fuel burning trucks. And even worse, it's simply incomprehensible for them to hide behind the mantra of we can't afford to pay the price premium for the electric vehicles. You can't afford not to. This is really serious business. And until the government speaks in that kind of language, we must pay the price premium because the externalities are too high, we're not serious. But let me just mention a couple other things. It's also a great example of how we need to think differently about requirements. Why should the Postal Service replace 150,000 trucks with 150,000 trucks? In the last 7 to 10 years, Germany, the Deutsche Post, has been taking trucks off the road and replacing them with e-bikes and electric cargo bikes, thousands of them. I think if Germany can do it, we can probably do it in our urban centers as well. In addition, the Postal Service has wildly blanket policies like we only use bicycles where they can be used 4 seasons a year. What's wrong with 3 seasons a year or 2 seasons a year or one? This is actually serious business. We should be thinking about it. But one more thing, and I want to go back to one of the things Donna mentioned earlier before, and it gets to one of Randy's issues as well. Think of this as a squandered opportunity. If the government, thinking strategically or proactively, decided to replace the entire fossil fuel burning fleet with electric vehicles, and turned every postal service in the country into a public charging station because they were already building the infrastructure. Think how much more accessible EVs would be to the general public and how much more quickly rural areas would adopt them. But that's the kind of big thinking that we need to be doing. And frankly, because of the way the IRA and so many pieces of legislation are negotiated, you have to deal with individual issues rather than broad programmatic paradigm type shifts. And that's a real disappointment.
Thanks, Steve. Donna, can you touch briefly on issues related to energy efficiency?
Sure. You know, we haven't talked much about energy efficiency, and I just want to point out that anytime you are harnessing and using energy, it's going to have an impact on the environment. It may have an environmental justice impact. The best thing we can do is energy efficiency. So I do applaud this bill for including energy efficiency. It is, of course, never enough. One of our big things that we have to address is the existing building stock. Not just the new buildings, that's important too, but the existing building stock. And anybody who owns a home knows it's incredibly expensive if you're talking about, say, replacing all your windows. And you know, you look at the credit, and yeah, it's higher now. It's like $500, $600 for replacing the windows in your house as opposed to the $200 cap it used to have, but it's still not enough. But the good thing is, the good news is, there is a lot of money in here that is going to HUD and for multifamily housing and for lower income residents. And you know, this is just one of those benefits that multiplies over and over. It improves health, it lowers costs, it lowers the externalities, it reduces our need for electric generation or other kinds of energy production. So I just want to both applaud and wish for more on the energy efficiency provisions of this act, because it's really, really important.
Thanks, Donna. So we have, according to my, we have about 11 minutes left. So if you have any questions, now is the time before we run out of minutes. So I'll turn to one of the questions we have in the Q&A, and putting them in the Q&A is probably the best bet at this point, if you have any, and we can answer them now. What are the key challenges the federal agencies like the EPA and or the private sector is encountering to fully follow through on IRA and ensure a just transition? Randy, do you want to go ahead and take a first stab at that?
Certainly. So I'll speak just from the EJ perspective here. Again, there are so many benefits potentially available to EJ communities with this legislation. And beyond what I mentioned in terms of the funding and the applicability points, I wanted to follow up briefly on Donna's points about the energy efficiency dimensions are also very, very well covered for EJ communities. There are new energy credits for small scale solar and wind facilities in these communities, USDA financial assistance for rural electric cooperatives in these communities, and $75 million for tribal energy loan guarantee program. But in terms of all of these great things that are meant to happen, one of the biggest challenges is the time frame within which these benefits need to be administered. And the government is not known for working at warp speed to implement the great things that it promises at the federal or state levels. So that's certainly one challenge. And another challenge from the EJ perspective is that there are terms that need to be defined more clearly or in the first instance. And one very important one from the EJ perspective is what do we mean by disadvantaged communities? And that is something that's not defined and will be subject to interpretation and could have a significant impact on the scope and effectiveness of these well-intended benefits that are meant to flow from the act.
Thanks, Randy. Rob, do you have additional thoughts?
Yes, I would say that one of the main challenges facing EPA as well as some other federal agencies in implementing the IRA or taking advantage of the subsidies it provides is having sufficient person power on board. Frankly, during the Trump administration, many federal agencies were hollowed out, pretty much gutted, lost a lot of people. EPA's workforce was reduced to a point during the Trump administration that was as low as it had been, I think, since the Reagan administration. Now, those people can be replaced, but a lot of them had years of experience, expertise, and institutional memory. And that's not as easy to replace as simply, hiring 10 people to replace 10 vacancies. So I think it's going to take a while for agencies to power back up to the point where they're going to be able to do everything that the statute theoretically allows them to do to achieve the climate benefits that the Inflation Reduction Act seeks to achieve.
Thanks, Rob. Now focus will start to turn to rulemaking. Donna, do you have thoughts on that?
Well, I just want, this really picks up on the prior conversation here, which is that we are now going to have to be moving into this phase of implementing this law. The Energy Bar Association, which I'm very active in, is having its conference simultaneously. And yesterday we heard from Sam Walsh, who's the general counsel at Department of Energy. And he said, get involved. There are pieces in here that it's really not clear what direction we would go in, and we need to hear from the private sector. We need to get input, to get involved in all of these different rulemakings about how this ought to be implemented and how things ought to be used. So just a call to action for everyone that, yes, we do need to get this implemented. And the other thing, and this goes to the environmental justice community's capacity building. So the ability for people to be able to participate in a meaningful way has to be paid attention to, I believe, and Randy might be able to comment on this. I think there is some money in IRA to support that, but to the extent that, universities and other people can help provide some of that support, that's a really important piece that has to be paid attention to.
Well, in our few remaining minutes, if there's any other questions, you can feel free to put in the chat, or if any of my colleagues have some additional thoughts that they want to share. I'm not Steve.
So one thing that I would just say, and again, this is slightly broader and somewhat off topic, but I think that one of the things that's so fascinating as we talk about the IRA is the unique position that we were in part because in the prior administration, we walked away from many of our commitments in the global community, and now we're trying to catch up again. But for those of you that don't follow the literature frequently, one recommendation that I always try to make in a group like this is, I realize that most of us cannot actually read and consume an IPCC report in its entirety. The Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change is a group of scientists. Their reports are massive, complex, and frankly, largely over my head. But every time they put out a report, they put out a summary for policymakers. And these are short, clear, powerful documents. And you often see them cited, but they're very good reminders about the kind of connections we need to be making. And frankly, one of the biggest challenges that we have with all of these policies in implementing them is getting people to focus on them. The challenges that we face with climate change have proven too big, too complex, and frankly, not profitable for the major media outlets. And of course, ownership of media outlets have changed as well. But one of the things that we can do is make part of our regular conversations the vocabulary, the impacts, the thinking, the strategies, the analytical tools, and the rubrics, so that we as individuals can not only think about changing our behavior, but we can persuade policymakers and politicians and others who are going to be active and vote to think more seriously about what we need to do to ensure a quality of life for our children and their children.
So I'm seeing two questions come in. First is on the electricity segment, the impact of the IRA will be limited without transmission expansion. Do you think the regulations will address this? I see Donna nodding.
Yeah, there is money in here for this. And this is another case in which it's also building on the bipartisan infrastructure bill. There were already some provisions out there. I think this came out of the bipartisan bill, one of the two, has money in there where DOE can actually become sort of the anchor tenant for a new line. They can actually agree to purchase the energy, so that will help. There is also money in there for improvements, for repurposing existing facilities, retooling, repurposing, reusing, I forget the exact language, but there's loan money out there for that purpose. So there is a lot of money that is going towards transmission. Whether that will still get us past some of the permitting issues, you know, one of the areas, of course, is this is a federal bill. It doesn't get us down to the state level. So there is still going to have to be some concerted effort to try to address some of the transmission problems.
Thanks, Donna. Andrew asks, are there any provisions within the IRA to try to confront the biodiversity collapse we're beginning to see, the sixth mass extinction beyond the $20 billion in farmland agricultural conservation? Does anybody have thoughts on that?
I think the short answer is it's all part and parcel. Okay, so I mean, realistically, addressing an individual species is probably not the way we're going to solve any of these problems, but attempting to mitigate climate change is what we have to do. And frankly, most of the species loss is pretty, I hate to call it water over the dam or history at this point, but it is what it is. One of the challenges with the IRA, however, is that some of the investment, and this makes sense, is on adaptation rather than mitigation. And adaptation to climate change does not address the biodiversity issues, sixth extinction and the like. But again, since we're recommending books, if you haven't read The Sixth Extinction, it's now somewhat dated, but it's still very, very powerful stuff.
Well, we are almost at our 75-minute mark. So I just want to take a moment. I will, full disclosure, if you couldn't probably tell from my role in this, I am the most ignorant person on this panel with respect to these issues. And I have to say, I have a strong feeling that a lot of people were like me, where the most of their attention is spent on the type of straw they use, a reusable bag, and what bin their recycling has to go into. But hearing today's discussion on how massive and extraordinary these efforts are, and the reach of these efforts is truly mind-boggling, and it really just emphasizes the task ahead of us. And I hope that for those of you that joined us today, that like myself, you learned something today. I certainly did. But more importantly, to get back to what Steve said at the outset of this program, the most important thing we can start to do is talk about this. And that's really what we did today. We're talking about this. We're getting this information out to a variety of communities. This is a very diverse group of attendees to this program, and we'll of course be circulating the video afterwards. But I consider this the start of many conversations on these issues, and look forward to future conversations with our colleagues on these important topics. So first, I want to thank our panelists for your time and just dedication to these issues, and for your time today. This was an incredible 75 minutes learning from you on these topics. But more importantly, thank you to you, the audience and the attendees, for joining us today and taking time out of your lunch to join in and ask really thoughtful and important questions. So again, the recording will be made available afterwards on the GW Law Government Procurement YouTube channel. And of course, you can reach us online if you have any follow-up questions after this. So again, thank you. And I hope everyone has a great rest of the week. Take care.